this fall will be November 17th. That will be from social work, Dr. Aisha John, and she's going to be speaking on supporting individuals with intellectual disabilities. So if anybody's interested, well, she's actually here. She is. Raise your hand. She'll be doing the one in November, so if you're interested in coming to that one, please feel free to RSVP to us again. We send out the calendar invite to all the faculty, but we don't send out the calendar invite to all the students. So if you are going to come, you'll just have to RSVP to either me, d.ray@tcu.edu, or to Sandy Barr, which is S.J.Barr. If you did it for this one, then you'd be able to do it again. And then we have a whole lineup for the spring. So if you didn't pick up one of these schedules as students, you might want to do that outside at the table. Two more things. If you're a graduate student or you're mentoring graduate students, so it is either faculty in this room working with grad students, or if you're a graduate student in this room, we're doing a competition called the 3-Minute Thesis Competition. We had training yesterday. We're having training for nurse anesthesia coming up. That training is to get you ready to prepare for something like this. Faculty can come to it as well as the students can come to it. For the actual competition, we taped yesterday's training, and you can get that if you want to in a Box account. We just need to know that you'd like to see it so that you can see the training. We've got it there. And then Alex, raise your hand, Alex, will give you permission. He'll share it with you so that you can get in the Box. Anybody that was there yesterday, I'm looking at Teresa right now, anybody that was there yesterday, we're going to give you permission. So you don't have to RSVP or tell me that you need it now. We'll get you in there. But if you weren't there yesterday and you do want access, please let Alex know and he'll get that information to you. The 3-Minute Thesis is going to be February 22nd at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. More information will be coming out about it. But it is a really fun event. It's just like going to the dollar store. How much are things in the dollar store? I hope so. If it says it's the dollar store, it better be a dollar, right? Well, on the 3-Minute Thesis, how long is the thesis presentation? Come on, play along.
3 minutes.
Thank you. 3 minutes. All right. So it's just very short, sweet, to the point. Keep it going. Okay, the last thing is that we are hiring a biostatistician. The biostatistician group, the committee, has picked some individuals to come in to be interviewed in person. Those interviews are going to take place, and this is mainly for faculty to know this, November 13th, 14th, and 15th. Please mark your calendars so that you can be part of that and be able to come for the faculty piece, the presentation, and for just kind of a sit-around forum to talk to this biostatistician. This is someone who's going to be working with you intimately with grants, publications, anything that you need stats help and support on. So you do want to be there if at all possible to see them in action to make sure that you get your vote on which one that you're most interested in having. All right? I think that's it for now. Now I'm going to bring up a very special guest today, Dr. Chris Watts from Communication Sciences. Are just loving the fact that you're getting to hear him again on Parkinson's disease. And I think it's going to be a useful topic for all of us. This is something that's actually affecting many people around us. We don't realize it half the time that it is. So I'm going to turn it over to Chris to get started.
Thanks,
Dr. Watts.
I think everybody knows who I am. If you don't, raise your hand. No. I don't have to give an introduction. That means we can finish earlier, which I know everybody wants. So my goals today are a number of things. Number one, to describe the characteristics and also the neuropathology of idiopathic Parkinson's disease. To introduce to the audience this concept of Parkinson's disease phenotypes, which is the focus of one of my lines of investigation. To hopefully make an argument that's successful that we need to investigate phenotypes and how they affect communication and swallowing in Parkinson's disease. I want to give you an overview of some recent research that we've been doing in my lab with students and give you some future directions for that research. You've all heard of Parkinson's disease. The reason why you've all heard of it is because actually it's quite common. In fact, behind Alzheimer's is the second most common neurodegenerative disease that we find in adults. And the classic signs of Parkinson's disease, well, there are really three, you could say four. Okay, the classic signs include bradykinesia. Another name for bradykinesia is hypokinesia. It means slow movement. So people with Parkinson's disease are slowed down. Also, rigidity. Rigidity refers to muscle tone, and specifically resting muscle tone, which in Parkinson's disease is increased. And so it makes their joints and their limbs stiff. So they're slower in moving, and they're also stiff. And then another classic sign, and this forms the classic triad, is tremor. So in Parkinson's disease, there is a resting tremor that occurs, or a postural tremor. So if they hold up an arm or a limb, the tremor will also appear when they hold it against gravity. It'll often go away during movement. But these are the classic triad. And then a lot of people will add postural instability. That is, individuals with Parkinson's disease have difficulty maintaining posture so they don't fall over, although this typically will occur later in disease progression. Many people have associated Parkinson's disease with this motor disorder. It's a disease of the motor parts of the nervous system. But actually, Parkinson's disease affects both motor and non-motor pathways. And in fact, leading theories would suggest that it's the non-motor pathways that are affected first in Parkinson's disease. And some of the non-motor pathways that are affected include those that deal with olfaction or your sense of smell. Other autonomic pathways, such as the gastrointestinal system, your digestive system, mood and behavior, and also sleep. All of these are affected in individuals who have Parkinson's disease. So, by the time someone is diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, it's very likely that they have been living with Parkinson's disease for up to a decade. They just didn't realize it. There is this prodromal period, or what's called a subclinical period, where Parkinson's disease is actually active in their nervous system. It's progressing through the nervous system and causing impairments that the person may or may not realize. But if they do realize them, they just don't associate these with a neurodegenerative disease. They may simply associate what's happening with them with getting older. And some of these things that are happening early on is a loss of sense of smell. Their smell acuity, if you will, becomes decreased. They have digestive problems, very frequent, and they have sleep disturbance. So one of the things that happens during sleep is they get restless legs, and their spouses will often report that they had to sleep in another bed because they're constantly kicking them in the night. But these are things that happen with other conditions that aren't Parkinson's disease, and also happen just with normal aging, and many people don't associate these things with having a disease. Then the disease will start to impact the motor pathways of the nervous system. We're going to talk a little bit more about those in just a bit. And when the motor pathways become substantially affected is when the person will notice that something is really wrong, and that will lead them to a physician, which will lead them to a neurologist, and they'll eventually get a diagnosis. And typically, by the time someone is diagnosed, what they have is this bradykinesia, this slowness of movement, and then either both or one of rigidity and tremor. And typically, to be diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, what is required is two or more of these triad of signs and symptoms, and a positive response to drugs that help relieve these symptoms. Okay. As Parkinson's disease progresses, we see these impairments in walking. We see people falling over. Their posture becomes hunched, and they have trouble just getting a movement started. And you may see them just freeze in place, or as they're trying to get up, just kind of freeze. It could be for 30 seconds or a minute before they get a movement going. So I mentioned that Parkinson's disease is quite common. It's typically diagnosed in the average individual somewhere in their 60s. The peak diagnosis is in the early to mid 60s. And a majority of individuals who will be diagnosed with Parkinson's disease are diagnosed after the age of 40. Those who are diagnosed before the age of 40 are said to have what's called early onset or young Parkinson's disease. Michael J. Fox, many of you are familiar with, would be an example of that. But over 90% are diagnosed, you know, 2 decades later than that. The prevalence is about 160 per 100,000 individuals. These are worldwide figures. About 15 to 20 new cases each year per 100,000 individuals. There's a slight favor of male to female here. Males always get stuck with the bad thing, so it's 1.5 to 1 here. And there are some effects of race and ethnicity, which suggests there are some genetic factors at play here that may predispose someone to getting Parkinson's. So we actually know what's going on that leads to the clinical symptoms that are Parkinson's disease. I just need to make sure I have this question. So we know that in neurons of the peripheral and central nervous system of individuals who have Parkinson's disease, there are excessive accumulations of this molecule called alpha-synuclein. And when these molecules congregate together, or clump together in abnormal ways, within the neuron they form these abnormal structures that are called Lewy bodies and Lewy neurites, named after Dr. Lewy, who discovered these. The effect of these abnormal alpha-synuclein inclusions in the neurons is that they starve the neurons basically of oxygen and end up killing the neurons. Okay? So in the peripheral and central nervous system pathways of individuals with Parkinson's disease, they have excessive accumulations of these Lewy neurites and Lewy bodies in different nerve pathways. Now, people who are older have Lewy bodies and Lewy neurites as well. The accumulation of these are considered, you know, just a phenomenon of aging. However, in people with Parkinson's disease, the accumulation is excessive. We also know that Parkinson's, or the degenerative process that's causing Parkinson's disease, begins in the lower brainstem. So you may have heard of the bottom of the brainstem being called the medulla, or the medulla oblongata. Or as the professor in the movie The Water Boy said, the medulla oblongata. Right. Now, everybody at this table gets that reference. Students, they don't get my movie references anymore. Did you, The Water Boy, you know this movie? Okay. It's very dear to me. When my wife was pregnant with our first child, we went to the movies to see The Water Boy and The Water Girl.
What are the chances?
That was some high quality H2O right there. So the disease, my students are used to this. It's just my colleagues are not used to this. So it begins in the lower brainstem. And slowly it works its way up. And I told you that someone who is diagnosed with Parkinson's disease may have had Parkinson's disease for up to a decade. Okay? And in these early stages, in the prodromal stages, neurons that are being affected by these alpha-synuclein deposits are down here in the lower brainstem and the medulla. And then it works its way up into the pons. And then it continues up into the midbrain. Then it continues up into subcortical structures, and eventually will work its way into the cortex. Okay? And again, this process can take up to a day. At the time someone starts to notice something is wrong with me, I can't move, I'm dragging my foot, my arm or leg just doesn't work as well, I have a tremor that I didn't have before. The disease has worked its way into the midbrain and areas of the subcortex called the basal ganglia. What you're looking at here is a coronal section of the brain, so it's been split into front and back, and the front part has been removed so you can see the inside. And inside here is a region of nerve cell bodies called the basal ganglia. And some of these nuclei associated with the basal ganglia are called the substantia nigra. And if you were to look at, and that's what this is, the substantia nigra removed from the brain, you would see that the area that is the substantia nigra is dark compared to the surrounding tissue. And that's because the neurons that are in this area of the substantia nigra are pigmented. And they produce a special neurotransmitter called dopamine. Okay. And when Parkinson's disease reaches the midbrain, it really has an affinity for these pigmented neurons. It like these alpha-synuclein Lewy bodies, Lewy neurites, like to congregate to these pigmented neurons. And in Parkinson's disease, this process will kill these neurons. So if you look at the brain of someone who doesn't have Parkinson's disease, this is what their substantia nigra would look like. If you look at the brain of someone who's had Parkinson's disease, those cells have died so that there's no pigmentation. Okay? And this is what causes the onset of the motor symptoms that are associated with Parkinson's disease. And I'll explain that. So some of the clinical signs are often associated with Parkinson's disease. I've mentioned bradykinesia. What we'll often see related to bradykinesia is this lack of facial expression. People with Parkinson's disease are said to have a masked face. You almost can't tell what they're thinking or what they're feeling. We see reduced arm swing when they're walking. Often people with Parkinson's will walk like this. They may freeze, especially as they're making a change in motor pattern, like turning from walking or even getting up from a chair. They have trouble just getting the movement started, and their movements are said to have low amplitude. So you may think of this as a decreased range of motion. A good example of this is in their handwriting. Their handwriting becomes very, very small, almost tiny. Okay, this is called micrographia. Also, as they walk, the amplitude of the contractions in their legs are much smaller too, so they take smaller steps as they walk. People with Parkinson's disease will tell you that they feel tight. You can actually assess the tightness in their limbs by passively moving them. The movement will resist your flexion and contraction movements. Okay? And that's because of excess muscle tone in throughout the skeletal muscles in the body. And then there's also this rest and tremor. Now, excuse the music that's going to play. It's going to be loud. That's what it looks like. Okay, we're done with the music. That's not my music. And a majority of people who have Parkinson's will at some point develop the tremor. But not everybody. And the degree to which that tremor is severe in anybody with Parkinson's disease also varies quite widely. That's important to remember, and we'll come back to that in a bit. So as the disease progresses, it will often lead to postural instability in many individuals. So their center of gravity becomes pushed forward because they hunch over, okay? And they have a lot of difficulty correcting balance problems as they ambulate, you know, as they walk around in their environment. And they become prone to falls because of the abnormal posture and then the abnormal reflexes that can correct a postural problem. So relative to communication, Parkinson's disease causes the following signs and symptoms. Typically, these individuals will have low volume of speech. They're often asked to repeat themselves because people can't hear what they're saying. They will often have a breathy voice quality. This is a voice quality that sounds hairy, like this, too much air in the voice. They will have prosodic abnormalities. Prosody, students, you know what this is. Prosody refers to the intonation and stress patterns in speech. In Parkinson's disease, these patterns become flattened. So there's reduced pitch variability, reduced loudness variability in their speech. They don't articulate as precisely as they did. Many people with Parkinson's will develop a fast or accelerated rate of speech. And especially in later stages, they can develop cognitive impairments. We would call this dementia. This is an example of what Parkinson's speech sounds like.
Rainbow and division of white light into many beautiful colors. These take the shape of a long round arch with its path high above and its two ends apparently beyond the horizon. Now, red, according to legend, a boiling pot of gold on one end.
Part of the problem in Parkinson's is trying to decipher what is Parkinson's and what is simply normal aging. So aside from Parkinson's, that sounded like an older person speaking. But there were some other elements in that voice and in that speech that kind of called extra attention to it. And those elements are the Parkinson's. So we know that Parkinson's disease is having some physiological effects that results in these clinical signs and symptoms. Often if we look at the vocal folds of people with Parkinson's disease, they will be bowed. That means they don't close completely. And this causes increased airflow through the vocal folds. Associated with this, they have bradykinesia, or slowness of movement in the laryngeal muscles. And this can be related to reduced vocal intensity, the breathy voice quality, and some of the prosodic abnormalities when they go to adjust fundamental frequency and intensity. We know that in their tongue and their lips and their jaw, their articulatory muscles, they have decreased range of motion, and this can affect the precision of articulation. We also know they have difficulty initiating utterances. You can ask someone with Parkinson's disease, tell me about what you did yesterday, and there may be this pause before they begin. They have difficulty getting the movement going. I know, and it's just, and you experience that when you're evaluating someone. Come on. And I mentioned speech rate. The research I'm going to talk about today is not focused on this, but something else that may be even more important than communication, which is growing in awareness, are the swallowing impairments that are secondary to Parkinson's disease. So when you swallow, you contract muscles. And these muscles need to move quickly, and they need to have an adequate range of motion to work effectively. And in Parkinson's disease, these muscles become slow, and their range of motion becomes reduced. And so we notice swallowing problems very frequently in people who have Parkinson's disease. They have problems controlling a bolus in their mouth, and then when they swallow, they have trouble getting that bolus to go down into the esophagus. And they also have trouble protecting the airway so that food or liquid doesn't go down the wrong pipe. Okay. So all of those things that I told you are associated with Parkinson's disease. But the reality is that everybody with Parkinson's disease is affected in a little bit different way. So the cluster or the constellation of all of these symptoms can be a little bit different in one person with Parkinson's disease compared to the other. And so today we understand Parkinson's disease as more of a heterogeneous disorder rather than homogeneous. It affects people in quite varied ways in terms of what symptoms they experience and how severe those symptoms are. And to try and understand this heterogeneity of Parkinson's disease, researchers have tried to identify subtypes of the disease. That is, the theory is that while people with Parkinson's disease share some of the same neuropathological degeneration, okay, there are different things going on in the nervous system in some that are not going on in the other. And this may explain why we see different clusters of symptoms present in some and not the other, and different degrees of severity in some and not the other. And these are just some of the different subtypes, or what I will call phenotype, of Parkinson's that have been studied. And the most common that has been studied is what we'll call the motor phenotype. Specifically, people who have a tremor-dominant form of Parkinson's disease or a non-tremor-dominant form of Parkinson's disease. And I'll define that a little bit more clearly in just a minute. So, people have subtyped Parkinson's disease into tremor-dominant or non-tremor-dominant in two different ways. There is a clinical test called the Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale, where parts of that test assess for tremor, and parts of that test assess for non-tremor types of impairments. And they use scores from that to differentiate people with Parkinson's disease into these two subtypes. Other researchers have simply used clinical history, other types of clinical information to subtype people. In the research that we're doing right now, we're using this lab method to subtype people into tremor-dominant and non-tremor-dominant Parkinson's disease. So I showed you this area in the brain here called the basal ganglia. Okay, I just want to name some structures because it's going to relate to the slides I'm about to show you. These two structures here, all of this is part of the basal ganglia, the stuff that's shaded in. This is the caudate nucleus and the putamen. Together, these are called the striatum. These two structures here are part of what's called the globus pallidus. This is the internal segment, and this is the external segment. And then this structure right here is called the subthalamic nucleus, and this structure here is called the substantia nigra. And remember, it was in the substantia nigra where these dopamine cells were, when they became impaired, the motor signs of Parkinson's disease were revealed. So, in these nuclei, there are different circuits or loops or pathways, and this is a schematic. You don't have to memorize this. I just want to use this to point out that there are two main loops going on in the basal ganglia. One is a direct pathway, and the other is an indirect pathway. And it's dysfunction in these pathways that helps us understand why we see what we do see in Parkinson's disease. And so I have created this as a handy-dandy way to explain this to you. So I'm like revealing this today. This is a showcase for you. I've never used this slide on anybody else. So this is why you come to TCU for moments like this, okay? So think about, first of all, what you need to know is that the motor regions of the cortex are constantly active, okay? And the motor regions of the cortex are constantly being stimulated by the thalamus. The thalamus has an oscillator which just goes, okay? And our brain knows that we have to control the activity in the cortex and the thalamus. Otherwise, you'd be fidgeting, moving all over. This is what your body wants to do, you know, if it's not being controlled. Luckily, we have the basal ganglia to help control this excessive activity. Okay, so all of you right now sitting there at rest, but inside your brain you have neurons coming from your globus pallidus to your thalamus, which are inhibiting activity in your thalamus, which then inhibits activity in the cortex. Because when you're resting, you don't want to move. You don't want movement, you just want to sit there. And so this circuit is constantly firing, and it inhibits movement, okay? However, when you want to move, we need to somehow put the brakes on this system. And this is where the direct pathway in the basal ganglia comes in. When you develop a motor plan, and you say, I'm going to execute that plan, there's lots of information that's shared in the brain. And part of that information flows through this direct pathway. That is, the cortex will send information to the striatum, exciting neurons in the striatum. This is the caudate nucleus and the putamen. This will then inhibit, or put the brakes on, the globus pallidus, which was inhibiting excitement in the cortex. So it allows movement to occur. Does that make sense? Now, if you think about flexing your arm, right? Typically muscles that move structures are paired, and there will be an agonist set of muscles and an antagonistic set of muscles, correct? So if you were doing this, you would want to make what muscles active? You want to activate what? Kinesiologists, come on. Say again? Exactly, but specifically on contracting. This wasn't so bulky, see this huge. What is that muscle called?
The biceps.
Thank you.
I know it's terrible.
It's just my shirt's bulky.
You can't see it. That was the problem. Yeah.
But I also want to decrease activity in the antagonistic muscles, right? To facilitate that movement, I don't want both agonist and antagonistic contracting at the same force at the same time, right? So I need to deactivate the antagonistic muscles. This is where the indirect loop comes in, okay? So there's another signal that goes from the thalamus to the antagonistic muscles that will activate them. So when we go to move purposely, we want to inhibit this. We want to inhibit this signal. And so there are other connections that go from the cortex to the different part of the globus pallidus, to the substantia nigra, to the globus pallidus internal segment, to those neurons of the thalamus, which end up inhibiting activity in the antagonistic muscles that help both initiate the movement and allow the movement to happen without restriction. Okay? Whenever you are thinking about executing a motor plan, or I should say your brain is, it also sends information to the substantia nigra. Do you remember what type of neurotransmitter is in the substantia nigra? Dopamine. This is where the dopaminergic neurons are. And the role of these dopaminergic neurons is to fine-tune the direct and indirect pathway. So neurons that use dopamine project up to the striatum to help fine-tune both the direct and the indirect pathway. It has different effects. It will excite the direct pathway, but it will actually inhibit the indirect pathway. Okay? In addition, we're designed quite eloquently. There are other neurons which are also helping to fine-tune. These are neurons that use acetylcholine. In Parkinson's disease, these neurons die. And so it causes problems in the regulation of activity in the direct and indirect activation. What ends up happening is that movements that are facilitated by the cortex become inhibited, so that the pathway cannot initiate movement and control movement. And this explains the bradykinesia, the slowness of movement, and and the inability to start movement that people with Parkinson's disease have. Okay? So this explains bradykinesia. I will also tell you that the cortex and the basal ganglia communicate with nuclei in your brainstem called the reticular formation. And when these motor regions are not working correctly, it will affect muscle tone through that pathway. And that's where rigidity comes from. Tremor, however, is associated with a different pathway. In your brainstem, not far from the substantia nigra, is a region called the retrorubral area. Retrorubral because it's in the vicinity of something called the red nucleus. There are also dopaminergic cells in this area. These also project to the globus pallidus, okay? And their role is to inhibit certain neurons in the globus pallidus. If these neurons were not inhibited, they would oscillate very rapidly. That is, they would just fire on and off very rapidly. And so these dopaminergic neurons are controlling that activity. When these neurons are lesioned, it creates a tremor signal that goes to the cortex. And there's a tremor circuit that goes from the cortex to the cerebellum to the thalamus and back up to the cortex. And this is what's causing the tremor. People with Parkinson's disease. So this pathway and the impairments that are elicited from the basal ganglia dysfunction that end up causing tremor are referred to as the dimmer switch hypothesis. That is, tremor begins in the globus pallidus, right? That acts like an on switch to the tremor. And then the tremor circuit from the cerebellum to the cortex of the thalamus acts like a dimmer switch. And in this case, the dimmer switch, instead of dimming the tremor, amplifies the tremor. Okay? Now, if the dimmer switch hypothesis is true, and there truly is this other pathway that's causing tremor due to a destruction of neurons in the retrorubral area outside of the substantia nigra, this becomes very important for understanding phenotypes, because what this may say is that people who have tremor-dominant phenotype are experiencing a different type of neuropathology and neurodegeneration than people who have non-tremor-dominant phenotype. That is, people who have more bradykinesia and rigidity rather than tremor. But what's interesting to me then is whether or not these phenotypes would experience different types of effects on voice, speech, and swallowing. Because if they did, perhaps we should be designing treatments that are more specific to their needs. How am I doing on time? Time is supposed to be one-ish? Then I'm fine. Any questions?
So, Michael J. Fox, why does he have such great effects?
So, what you see in Michael J. Fox is not due to, well, so a lot of what you see, this, is actually not due to Parkinson's disease. These are dyskinesias that are due to the medication that he took for Parkinson's disease. Over time, this medication actually causes further destruction in the basal ganglia, causing other abnormal hyperkinesias. So what neurologists will do these days is they will try and delay for as long as they can dopamine replacement drugs. Because we know that the longer someone takes them, the more at risk they're going to be for developing these dyskinesias like this. So here's the problem. Voice articulation and swallowing impairments are salient manifestations. This is a very clear, very obvious manifestations of Parkinson's disease, and they occur actually very early in the disease. Some people have tried to identify them during that prodromal, preclinical stage. But they can occur very early in Parkinson's disease. At the same time, we know that when someone comes to a clinic with voice, speech, or swallowing problems, we can improve function in those individuals. However, we don't know if the degree to which someone is impaired and, you know, what parts of communication or swallowing are impaired, we don't know how that's affected by phenotype, although we know that these phenotypes or subtypes exist. We literally don't know anything because no one has really studied this concept of Parkinson's phenotype in the context of speech and swallowing. And I would suggest that this is important that we know, or is important for us to know this, because if a person's impairment profile is unique to their Parkinson's phenotype, then we need to make sure that we're treating the profile, treating the impairments that are specific to the patient, not that are specific to Parkinson's disease in general. Okay. So knowing phenotype and knowing impairment profiles associated with phenotype could help us during the process of differential diagnosis of speech, voice, and swallowing. So some of the major questions in my current line of investigation are, what are the profiles associated with motor phenotype? Are there other factors that might influence these voice, speech, and swallowing impairment profiles? And then what phenotypic and disease-specific factors will predict the decline and the severity in speech, voice, and swallowing? So some of the data that I'm going to report to you today came from the thesis by this lady here, Brittany Burke. She's out in the real world getting her certificate of clinical competence right now up in Illinois. But when she was with us, she did a thesis, and this is part of her data set. So her thesis looked at the effect of tremor phenotype on acoustic and aerodynamic measurements. She recruited people who were identified as tremor dominant, people who were identified as non-tremor dominant, and then healthy older controls who did not have Parkinson's disease and did not have any other neurological impairments. So the way that we classify tremor dominant and non-tremor dominant Parkinson's were with this criteria. Someone was tremor dominant if tremor was present at the onset of the disease, it progressed in severity over the course of time that they've had it, and it remains as one of the most significant impairments of the disease at the time of testing. People were classified as non-tremor dominant if they didn't have tremor at onset, there was minimal, if any, tremor that developed over the course of the disease, and they would tell you at the time of testing, yeah, tremor is the least of my worries. It's really not something that is that severe for me. So this is how we subtype the individuals. These were our operational definitions. And I put this reference down here because we didn't make this up. There were other researchers who've used a similar methodology. So we recorded individuals speaking in a couple of different contexts. We hooked them up to a microphone, and we recorded them sustaining the vowel ah, and then reading a sentence, "We were away a year ago." These are diagnostic stimuli that clinicians typically use during a typical voice evaluation. And if you look at the research literature that assesses acoustic characteristics of voice, these are the typical stimuli that have been recorded in the literature. And then we hooked them up to a face mask that was connected to an aerodynamic system. And we had them do similar things. We had them repeat pa, pa, pa. And we had them say the sentence, "We were away a year ago." From the acoustic and aerodynamic recordings, we were able to acquire two dependent variables, or two measurements, something called kestrel peak prominence and something called transglottal airflow. And this is what those two things represent. Kestrel peak prominence represents the periodicity or the regularity of vocal fold vibration. Typically, when you hear someone who has a pleasant sounding voice, that is, it doesn't sound rough or breathy or hoarse, they have a lot of periodicity to vocal fold vibration. But when you hear someone who sounds hoarse, their vocal folds are not vibrating periodically. There's a lot of aperiodicity, irregularity in vocal fold vibration. Kestrel peak prominence is a measure of that regularity. The larger kestrel peak prominence, the more regularity there was in vocal fold vibration. The lower that measure, the more aperiodic that vibration is. And we know that this measure corresponds very well to your perception of how hoarse someone is, okay? Transglottal airflow is a measure of how much air is flowing through the vocal folds each second. And we measure it in milliliters per second. And the theory is that if someone has a gap in their vocal folds, that is, they don't close all the way, there would be more air flowing through the vocal folds than if someone's cords could close all the way each time they came together during vibration. Okay. So these were the two measurements. So here's some demographic information on our participants. This is the mean age, or the mean years post-diagnosis for our tremor dominant and non-tremor dominant. The age at which they were diagnosed. Hoehn-Yahr staging, which is a way to categorize the overall severity of Parkinson's disease. The larger this number, the more severe it is. There are five stages of Parkinson's on the Hoehn-Yahr scale. We also have listeners rate overall perceptions of speech severity. How bad does this person sound? Using a magnitude estimation procedure where a score of 100 represented a moderate degree of speech severity. And I can tell you on all four of these variables, our tremor dominant and non-tremor dominant groups did not differ. Okay? There was no statistical difference in any of these mean measurements. So we had all of these speakers, including our controls, go through the tasks that I just described. And this is what we found. These are the acoustic results. So these are the kestrel peak prominent measures from sustained vowel and during connected speech. And what we found is that there was a significant effect of group on kestrel peak prominence in vowels. That is, our non-tremor dominant group had significantly lower kestrel peak prominence than both the tremor dominant group and the controls. And these two groups were not different from each other. This wasn't true in speech, though. In our aerodynamic measurements, we found the exact same pattern. That is, individuals with non-tremor dominant forms of Parkinson's disease had more airflow through the vocal folds when they were speaking in the vowel compared to tremor dominant and healthy controls who were not different from each other. We did not find that in speech. So what we found then is that individuals who had a non-tremor dominant phenotype of Parkinson's disease exhibited less phonation periodicity than tremor dominant Parkinson's and control. We also found the same pattern with airflow. There was greater airflow through the vocal folds in non-tremor dominant than there was tremor dominant. However, we didn't find this effect in connected speech when they were saying we were away a year ago. So what does this all mean? And how are we going to use this information moving forward? Well, perhaps what we are measuring here is this phenomenon that in tremor dominant and non-tremor dominant Parkinson's disease, there are different neuropathological processes going on in the nervous system, and specifically in these basal ganglia pathways, that manifests in voice production. Okay, that is, we were actually measuring the differential effects of what's happening in the nervous system that causes tremor dominant Parkinson's versus non-tremor dominant Parkinson's. And perhaps this would cause us to maybe reevaluate how we consider someone with Parkinson's disease when they come into the clinic. Perhaps we need to start thinking about what subtype this individual might fit in. Okay? Because perhaps that's going to influence how we detect impairments or how we think about impairments, and certainly it could influence how we might tailor a treatment to the individual rather than tailoring the treatment to Parkinson's disease, which is really what we do now. Someone has Parkinson's disease, okay, this is what we do for Parkinson's disease. Okay. However, this was a very early investigation. It needs to be replicated through larger samples. We need to make sure that we validate our methodology for subtyping people with tremor and non-tremor dominant Parkinson's disease. We need to look at other ways of measuring acoustics and aerodynamics. So we use one acoustic measurement. There are other more sophisticated ways to analyze the acoustics. Perhaps we may find something in speech rather than just a vowel if we measure things in different ways. And then also we need to look at swallow function. This study did not look at that, although swallow impairments can cause an even greater deterioration in quality of life than voice impairments can. And so these are some of the projects that are going on in my lab. We are looking at multidimensional measurements of acoustics and aerodynamics. We are beginning to look at swallow function as a function of phenotype in my lab. And these are some of my lab rats who are working on specific projects associated with these things right now. So in the next few years, we will have a lot more information and hopefully a lot greater understanding about how Parkinson's phenotype influences voice, speech, and swallow. So, thank you for your time. Questions?
I have two. Can you go back to the bridge chart? So is it common that one of your participants was diagnosed at 25? That seems really young.
They were not diagnosed at 25. Yeah. Did I have it?
Yeah. Oh, that's the range. Never mind. That was being returned up. My other question is, you mentioned when you talked about speech and communication, the characteristics of participants with Parkinson's. You said they have a hard time initiating. Is that motor planning? Is that related to what you were, the chemicals and the neurons, or is it a factor of age?
Well, they have much greater impairment of initiation even than healthy controls. That's been well established
for
all motor movements, all voluntary motor movements.
Match
for age, yes, absolutely.
And how come they don't believe it goes from match to cognitive?
In Parkinson's disease, the reality is that especially when you get to the middle to later stages, everybody with Parkinson's is going to have some level of cognitive impairment that'll be much greater than an age match control. So it becomes confounding in that way. But the reason why they have difficulty initiating. Is because of the lack of inhibition in these pathways. It doesn't kickstart the movement, which is one of the roles of dopamine through the direct and indirect activation pathways, getting the extra boost to get the movement. So, yes, we know that there are genes called the Parkin family genes that can cause Parkinson's disease. However, the number of cases of individuals who have diagnosed Parkinson's disease where it's linked to these genes is around 5%. Very low percentage, but yes. The majority of cases are said to be idiopathic, meaning they have Parkinson's disease, but we really can't say why. We don't know why they have it, but we know what's happening. But we don't know why they got it.
Any of the subjects in your study have pharmacological interventions, or are you testing on that or off that?
So, yes. In fact, all of them did. All of them minimally were taking levodopa, which is a dopamine replacement drug to help restore dopamine levels. The only control mechanism we used for that was when we scheduled them to come in, we asked them to give us a time where their medication would be most effective. So they were in there on time. But otherwise, we didn't control for that.
Yes.
You're saying it may be more obvious because of tremor.
The voice.
So kind of like a holy grail in Parkinson's research is to find these signs in the prodromal period before it reaches the true clinical stage. Because if we could identify, oh my gosh, you have early Parkinson's disease, maybe there's medications that they could get to reverse it. By the time someone's diagnosed with Parkinson's, it's been estimated that 80% of the dopaminergic neurons in the basal ganglia are dead. It's like too late to reverse. However, related to your question, our findings actually align very well with similar literature that's looked at limb motor deterioration in Parkinson's disease, and that is, people with non-tremor dominant Parkinson's disease progress faster, that is, they get more severe quicker than people who have tremor-dominant Parkinson's disease. And this also includes cognition. Their cognition goes downhill much quicker. That's to say, if you're gonna have Parkinson's disease, you want a tremor-dominant form, not a non-tremor-dominant form. It would be best to identify these people who were non-tremor-dominant using some method. And so we and other teams have looked at acoustics as possibly a way to determine who not has what phenotype, that's what we're looking at, but do they have Parkinson's disease?
I think that's the biggest problem right now, is that people don't know to even look for these symptoms for Parkinson's
yes.
in non-tremor individuals. Therefore, even if they have it, we don't know they're looking for it. And even then, it does go across many different things.
So they are looking at markers in the blood, markers from biopsies of different tissue. Not yet, but they're trying. I mean, that research is looking into these things. Certainly, if you can do neuroimaging, there are very clear differences in the brain of someone with Parkinson's. But I mean, who just gets a regular neuroimaging right for that?
Clinically, there's been some work in terms of gait and the symmetry between leg swinging and arm swing symmetry as an indicator of early onset Parkinson's disease. And part of that stems back from Michael J. Fox example, and looking back at some of his gait characteristics when, you know, before we even knew he had Parkinson's, because we could see some changes that were going on. So trying to find a clinical measure that's not blood-weighted, but that's used as a gait analysis has been done, and we're starting to work on the validity of that.
One of the very common patterns that we have found in our lab, which is also consistent with is that when you do a clinical history, the people who fall into the non-tremor dominant group frequently report falls. They fall frequently. People with tremor dominant, most of them will say, no, it's not a problem. The non-tremor dominant folks have a lot more balance and gait issues. And that's, again, I think, just supporting this theory that the nervous system is being affected in different ways as a function of phenotype. And what we have measured so far in these early stages are some effect on, you know, laryngeal behavior during voice recognition. Thank you for your time.